So I tell you guys all the time that I like to make video content directly from my inbox. Questions that I'm asked often enough to trigger me going, you know, I should probably make a video about that. So today's mission, should we choose to accept it, is gonna be answering the age-old question. Are custom graphics cards actually worth it? So today we're gonna talk about what kind of led to custom graphics cards, what's changed in 2019, and try and decide whether or not you should even spend the extra cash on a custom graphics card.
The Sennheiser HD58X Jubilee headphones offer everything audio enthusiasts desire, continuing from a long line of innovation. Weighing in at just 260 grams, gold-plated connector, 1.8 meter detachable cord, and full rich sound make the Sennheiser HD58X headphones from Drop the obvious choice for those who are serious about sound. Sign up for Drop is always free, so take advantage of this deal by heading to Drop using the link in the description below.
So I'm gonna try and make this as concise as possible. There's a lot to talk about, and some of it's relevant, some of it isn't. I tend to ramble. This right here is a 1080 Ti, blower style cooler. This is the way that the reference cards and Founders Edition cards were since the beginning of time, because they didn't depend on chassis airflow to keep them cool. Air in, air out, that was it, done deal. But as you can see now, we have dual fan cards that exist with RTX because of the core density, the extra heat that is involved in these. And the reason why we're even talking about this is because this is typically what the custom cards offered you. Custom cards, long before the Furtherwind 3s and the Strix cards and all that sort of stuff, were just reference-based PCBs that had better coolers on them, and that counted as a custom card. But the reason why we're talking about this as well is something happened with the 1080 Ti, and that was the fact that NVIDIA went into business for themselves, not just creating this stuff and selling it to the board partners, but also selling it directly to retailers, or I guess retail consumers. And so what that meant was, because NVIDIA designed it, of course they want to be the best card on the market. So they pre-bin all the silicon, keep it for themselves, the best ones anyway, come out with the Founders Edition cards, which are higher than the reference cards when it comes to boost clocks and base clocks and all that sort of stuff, and then sell the leftovers to the AIBs. That kind of changed things in 2018 because, well, specifically 2018 with RTX, but even earlier than that with Pascal. Because as you can see right here, it's the exact same PCB layout. I could interchange the coolers between the RTX 2080 Ti and this Black Edition card from EVGA back and forth. They would all match up. But this card has a significantly lesser boost clock at 1545 versus 1635, again, because of binning. Reason why we're even mentioning binning once again is the coolers are not the only thing that differentiates custom cards from MSRP cards. You can see that although we do have a better cooler on this Black Edition than we do on the Founders Edition card, in my opinion, in terms of functionality. Now, aesthetics, that's a whole different discussion. It's perfectly subjective, so we're not gonna even touch that. But you can see that there's more of an airflow between the fans and the PCB with the Black Edition card than the Founders. It's very choked off with the Founders. It's very aesthetics over function, which means this card could still reach upwards of 80 degrees depending on the chassis that it was in, because now it depends on your chassis to keep it cool. But now, because the manufacturers really have to stand out and work really hard at making their designs better than the ones that NVIDIA is keeping for themselves, they come out with things like this, the Furtherwind 3 and the hybrids and all that sort of stuff, because they've got to stand out. I know this seems like an EVGA ad. The only reason I'm even showing these EVGA cards is because it's the one brand that I receive product from that I know for a fact comes from retail allocation. So I know that what I'm getting here is indicative of the customer experience because it comes from the same exact shelf. So what we've got right here is the Furtherwind 3. As you can see, it's, you know, the guy she tells you is just a friend and this is you and that's it. But something's happening now. Because the manufacturers are getting the leftovers, and I hate to even use that term, but that really is what it is, because NVIDIA is keeping the best binned GPUs for themselves. By GPU, I mean the actual die that goes in the inside. The manufacturers are then having to come up with their own hierarchy of binning based on the leftovers. So that means even the best binned GPUs that are received by the AIBs often are not as good as the ones that NVIDIA keeps, because that's why NVIDIA kept them. Because you can test all that silicon quality before you ever cut the wafer and then start making the GPU and the dies and all that. Same thing happens with CPUs. It's how you have a product stack. Then you have the hybrid card over here, which in my personal opinion, if water cooled is the way to go. Not just because I'm the, I don't know, I guess the self-proclaimed water cooling guru on YouTube, but because the way GPU boost works, the colder you can keep the die, the higher it will boost on its own. And then the higher you can even overclock it, especially RTX. It's highly dependent on keeping it nice and cool. So that's why you get these giant 2.75 slot Furtherwind 3 behemoth cards that I almost dropped. As you can see, significantly longer. It's got everything she wants for her pleasure and yours for gaming. And it's got extra functionality though, because what they have to do is they have to add value to these cards. It can't just be the fact that this has a 1755 megahertz boost clock versus the 1545. So we're already talking 210 megahertz higher on average. But it's got a fan header on the back that allows you to plug in another cooler or case fan or a splitter to multiple case fans and allow them to speed up and slow down with the GPU load, keeping your chassis as cool as possible so this doesn't start to drop clocks on you. It's also got an RGB header because I know EVGA probably didn't want to put that in there, but 2019 dictates it has to be there. But not only does it have the better cooler and all these extra little doodads on the PCB, it's a custom PCB itself. That's why it's so big. It's got a very beefy, very oversized power delivery, which means that you're gonna have longevity. The power delivery can handle the overclocking. It's built for overclocking. It's built to run long and hard and put away wet. That's exactly what it's meant to do. But the question is whether or not with that binning thing we talked about, is it even worth building these? So let's go ahead and put it on the test bench and see what happens. Now, before we get started with the testing here, there's a couple settings I wanna show you that I am going to be manipulating on this. Normally you'd use Precision X1 with the EVGA cards, but we're using Afterburner because of the better charting that we can show what happens with temps and power limit and all that stuff. We're gonna be moving power limit to all the way to the right, whatever it maxes out. This number will be different for the Founders versus the Black versus the Furtherwind 3. And then we're gonna be putting temperature target with it. What that's gonna allow us to do is let the cooler do its job, let the card have more headroom to ramp up to, so we can see if these PCBs and the silicon binning is mattering. If we're hitting power limit and all that prior to ever letting the cards hit their max potential, then, I mean, that's one test you could do, but I don't feel anyone buying a card at this level or any custom card should be leaving those sliders at stock. Again, because we want the card to also find its max potential, we're going into the 3D settings here in the NVIDIA control panel, and we're changing two settings. We're changing power management mode from optimal to prefer maximum performance, and then we're changing texture filtering quality to high performance. That's just gonna allow the card to also draw as much power and just go as full tilt as it possibly can. These are also some of the settings that we change when we do our overclocking with LNT and all that sort of stuff. So with that said, and some of the methodology about why we're doing that out of the way, let's go ahead and just run some synthetics. Reason why we're running synthetics is we're not showing you how the card performs in games, we're showing you how the cards perform versus each other. And synthetics are the only way to get 100% perfect run back to back to compare those numbers. So we just spent the entire day testing all of these cards, both in stock trim, with power limit moved, like I mentioned, overclocking, crashing, overclocking again, crashing again, finding stable overclocks, because that's kind of the other side of the coin when it comes to this discussion, is the custom cards are not just about cooling, but also about, like I said, the bin within the hierarchy of their own brand that they live within, and then overclockability, which is what you get with something like the Furtherwind 3. Now, I also included the Kingpin here, not because we test it, but because aesthetically, they look very similar in terms of the PCB design. But even the Kingpin card with its 240 millimeter AIO radiator and liquid cooling and temperatures being a lot lower than any of these would get even on air, would barely edge out the Furtherwind 3, because there's another aspect to this that's super important. In order to get the GPUs to perform at their absolute best regarding their ASIC quality, you've got to super cool them. What we found, especially when we did the Kingpin with the air conditioner hooked up to it when we tested this card, was as you get it down towards 0C, then you start to get more core clock with it. So what we found here, if we take a look at these three cards, and we're gonna do another video actually where we kind of do a sort of a sliding scale where we find just based on controlling the temperature, how much core clock do you get and how sustainable is it? Just to kind of show how temperature directly relates to performance. Now the Founders Edition is $1,199 US. The XD Black, $1,149 US. So $50 less than the Founders Edition card. And then the Furtherwind 3 comes with the hefty price tag of $1,500. So you can see that it can slide up price-wise very much so. But if we go ahead and take a look at some of the stock charts here, and remember, this is power slider moved to the right, along with temperature target moved to the right, so that the card could boost as much as it wants to without hitting this artificial cap. Really what the card is capable of is whatever those are moved to the right. It's just anything less than that's very conservative. Now, if we go ahead and take a look here at Time Spy Extreme, the Founders Edition got a 7,048, whereas the XC Black, and I need to correct myself too, by the way, because I called it just a Black Edition. I thought it was just a black gaming. It's actually an XC black. So it's a little bit higher on the core clock. Instead of 1545, it's actually 1560, 15 megahertz. EVGA, why so many SKUs with such narrow gaps? Please simplify your product stack. Please. But regarding times by extreme, 7,048 for the FE with the power and temp slider. The XC Black was 7,058. So you can see they are 10 points difference, which is what we expected because both of these cards are the same PCB. I'm fairly certain that even though this is a reference board, because we're dealing with aftermarket, which where the company will typically add their own BIOS tweaks to it, which is gonna make this go higher than the FE card, or at least, well, let's do that again. And one of the things that makes these cards different from the AIB though, is even though it is a reference card, and this is the Founders Edition is just a reference PCB with a different BIOS that allows higher boost clocks and base clock and all that, which is exactly what the AIBs do as well. So even though this says 1560, this was boosting up to the same 1950 this guy was. The difference is silicon ASIC quality and temperatures are gonna determine how long it'll maintain those clocks. So that's what you're seeing between these two cards. The only thing varying the scores between them is how long one card maintains its max boost clock versus the other. But now when we move on over here to the For the Win 3 Ultra, we get a 7,136. So not even 100 points higher at $300 higher, not even 100 points. But again, that's because until you start manually overclocking this card, you're not gonna see any benefit from going with a custom card. Now, if we go ahead and move on to some of the rest of the scores here, Firestrike Ultra, we got an 8385 on the FE card. We got a 8411 on the XC Black. Now, Firestrike Ultra, the reason why we include that with TimeSpy is it's two different engines. TimeSpy is DX12, Firestrike is DX11. DX11, for whatever reason, tends to be a little bit harder on the GPU to run. We notice more boost reduction in Firestrike than we do in DirectX, or in, than we do in TimeSpy, so that's why we include it. But we saw a little bit more of a boost retention with this card because the cooler is that much better. Also too, it has to do with the stock fan curve. The efficiency of the FE cooler versus the XC Black cooler, this is keeping the card much cooler. We were seeing 74-ish on average on the FE, but we did see the Black get up as high as 80, 81, which then causes it to fall down in some of the other tests, as you'll see. The For the Win 3 in Firestrike Ultra, 8410. So as you can see, it's roughly the same as the Black. When we look at the other tests we have on here, Shadow of the Tomb Raider, we have a 1440 and a 4K. We've got Superposition. When you take a look at these charts right now, you'll notice that they're all just kind of hovering around the same mark, you know, 1% plus or minus depending on the test. That's because even though we have a massive cooler on the For the Win 3 and we have a better cooler on the XC Black than the Founders Edition, the P state or the boost bin or whatever you want to call it, the maximum on these is basically the same, 1980 to 1950. And then they fall down from there depending on their temperature. So that's why until you start manually overclocking, you're not gonna see a commanding lead on any of these three cards. Now, one of the things that we know with the custom cards, especially with our overclocking competition and stuff we've been doing with the Kingpin cards, is that as you move up the stack with EVGA at least, this does usually apply to all the manufacturers. Their pricing and their models are specifically binned that way. It's very rare that you would find like an ASUS Turbo 2080 Ti matching speeds of say the Strix, because they are binned that way. Not just are they overbuilt, the GPUs are, you're not gonna find them taking a bin GPU and throwing it in a turbo. You might get lucky, but for the most part, it's the stack usually determines the level of performance that you're gonna get. So we were seeing well over 2100 on the For the Win 3. We were only seeing 2085 on the Founders Edition because Founders Edition was just above that, we were crashing. We were also able to get around 2115 on our Black, but again, because the cooler is not as built as our For the Win 3, we saw more reduction in the turbo clock. Even though we manually set it, if we hit power limit, which we were, this is going to drop. Because we have a higher power limit on the custom card because of that custom built VRM, the clocks maintain themselves higher. So as you look through these charts right here, you can see that the For the Win 3 definitely took a commanding lead and it did it at a considerable less temperature. If I recall correctly, I believe 62 or 63 C was the max temperature that we saw on the For the Win 3. So you've kind of seen how everything sort of lays out, how all of these cards, when they're stock with the power target pushed up, all hover around the same you would never notice the difference. No one would be able to walk in here and tell me which card was which if they were playing on them in a blind taste test. But what you do get with the custom cards that makes it potentially worth the premium, and this one's a $300 price premium over Founders or $350 above the XC Black, is the quality of components that are handpicked for these particular cards. With the exception of the Kingpin, because those are even further handpicked and binned, you get a bin GPU that you know is top of the stack that EVGA tests when they get these GPUs. You get handpicked parts for like the best MOSFETs, the best chokes, and the best RAM that you can get in here. You don't get that with the Founders Edition. In the overclocks, I don't know if you noticed by looking at the charts, we achieved a 1300 plus on the RAM. Not that much on the memory. I mean, we got the GPU. We got the GPU well over 2100. But the RAM at plus 1300, that's actually an effective 2.6 gigahertz overclock on the memory because of the handpicked bend memory that goes into this as well. On the XC Black, we only used the plus 750 because anything above that was starting to give us artifacts. And Phil basically was like, well, wait a minute. Did you even try and go that high on the Founders Edition card? And I was like, well, no, I know it can't go that high. I've tested this stuff in the past. It's like, but I think you should test it just for the sake of sanity to make sure this is all done right and that we don't leave any questions on the table. I showed him that the second we even tried 1200 on this, which is 100 less than we got here, instant black screen with then random black and white checkerboard all over the screen. And then even though we did plus 750 on this, if we did plus 1000, it was unstable, plus 1050 instant crash. So it's because NVIDIA is binning their GPUs, but we feel they're just using whatever chip supplier they've got. There might even be a mix of Hynix and Samsung on the same board. We've experienced that on one of our Titans, actually. It was a mixed RAM situation. So what you're getting with these custom cards is potential. You're getting the bin GPU, you're getting the handpicked parts, but it's not necessarily worth it unless you are doing things like overclocking and doing ice bucket challenges and water cooling it. Because what I think they should do, and last time I did this and I said I think someone should do something, someone did it and didn't give attribution where attribution was due, but I digress. They should start selling these cards with no coolers. You should sell the Kingpin card with no cooler as far as I'm concerned, because the people that would take advantage of what these cards are capable of are going to rip these coolers off to begin with. If that's not you, it's not worth it. I personally don't feel the Founders Edition cards are worth it because you leave a lot on the table in terms of overclocking and temperatures and acoustics, because these two are way quieter than this guy. This guy might look a little nicer, but at the end of the day, like I said, I don't care what it's called. I also don't care what it looks like if it gets me the performance I want and the best value for my money. And value is meaning anything I get above the baseline of what you would pay for something, that's value. So the XC Black is actually one of my favorite cards on this table because of the fact, two slot design, double cooler.
And it's cheaper.
It's cheaper, $50 cheaper, and it overclocks better. So even though it didn't necessarily beat the Founders Edition on all of it, I have a feeling once we put a water block on here, that story would change. But if you're the kind of guy that's also like, I want the bin GPU and I'm gonna water cool, well, the Founders Edition might be for you. I know this video doesn't necessarily concrete answer the question of whether or not it's worth it for you, but it's giving you some information so you can at least understand why these different SKUs exist and kind of a way to look at them. So anyway, what do you guys think we should test in the future? Like I said, we're going to do temperature testing where you can see how the GPU core clock directly relates to temperature, something we've had to learn through LN2 cooling around here by being a complete noob at it. It's a fun topic. So if you guys want to see that, make sure you mash that like button down below. And if you're new around here, hit subscribe so you can check out these other videos that cover these topics. Thanks for watching, guys. I know this one was probably a longer one, but important information to talk about. As always, we'll see you in the next one.